Orhan Pamuk, it's interesting coming from Turkey because it's a tension between East and West, between old and new. And some of that is in this novel, particularly the old and new. After all, the technology of digging a well is extremely old, and yet it is being dug in order to bring about a modern new development.
In 1988, I spent my summer in a place writing one of my books, and in the land next to me, there was an old-fashioned, one of the last well diggers, and a young disciple, and they begin digging a well. And since I was very close to them, and since they wanted, sir, can we have some electricity, some water? And for 3 minutes, I paid attention to the relationship between the well digger who was teaching the craft to a sort of a teenage disciple, but was also shouting as he taught, but also at nights when they were watching their TV or just before their sleep, enjoying the food they cooked at the place, that he was very attentive, tender, understanding, and was talking to the, so to speak, child or the boy in a very tender way, which moved me, perhaps because my father, I was raised by a father who was a bit absent, not attentive in both a negative and positive way. He didn't suppress me. He never shouted at me, but he was not around and giving me advice or protecting me in this very intimate way that fascinated me. And I began to think about this subject. And just before they left, I asked them, you know, I'm a writer, something like a journalist at that time, and I was not very well known then. And would you, can we please talk? And we talk. And there he mentioned his story about a well digger who was bought himself, actually, who was bought to a barren land at the edges of Istanbul some years ago. And he dig and dig and dig, and they couldn't find water. And this story, like an essential story about finding water, passion, and in my part of the world, and digging a well is, and finding water is something like finding treasure. Suddenly, the value of your land, everything. Then water brings civilization, so to speak. So I thought about this story for many, many years.
I just wondered whether the boy has more in common with you even than the question of the father figure, because he wanted to be a university student, but he didn't have the money, and he had to go and help dig this well instead. You wanted to be an architect, and you studied to be an architect, but in fact you became a journalist and a writer.
It's also, a coming age of, so to speak, a coming of age novel, but it's also, wants to be the novel, a sort of a novel of ideas. Now that I focused on the relationship between father and son, I thought about it and decided at one point, with the help of a theater outside the outskirts of a little village invented, compared this intense father-son story with both Sophocles' Oedipus Rex and Firdevsi's a story in Firdevsi's Shahname, Book of Kings. The story is Rustam and Sohrab, and they are symmetrical stories reflecting each other, in which Oedipus kills his father without knowing it and thus breaks a taboo. And we today, we moderns, then celebrate his individuality, while Rustam kills his son without knowing it. And we also excuse him because it's the continuity of the army, the state, the society. The authoritarian Asian ruler needs the power to kill his son. And as he cries, we all legitimize, and it all legitimizes his authoritarianism. Thus, of course, I was thinking of Turkey today, when and the country is getting authoritarian, and this story resonates with what's happening in Turkey, not pointing out to figures, political figures, this or that, but in a general way that my novel asks questions about, let's call it, Oriental despotism, which is an old-fashioned, a bit politically incorrect term, authoritarianism growing in my part of the world. In the end, the essential question the novel perhaps is relevant today is, are the questions both valid in Turkey, not only in Turkey, say in India, where the voters are making a choice between, on the one side, economical growth and immense booming of the economy, and on the other hand, liberal rights, liberties, and the governments, nationalist governments, who are getting increasingly authoritarian, are asking, are demanding that they vote for more power rather than liberal values. But the regular, the old-fashioned sociological story about Third World, it used to be that as these countries get richer, more economically powerful, civil society will develop and democracy would also develop. Perhaps my novel is asking, it's not happening, or perhaps that up to now had not happened in Turkey. It was happening. We were getting some democracy, and suddenly it fell down. The movements of democracy and economical boom is perhaps not parallel.
What is interesting is that you have stayed in Turkey, and you and it is almost as if the country is moving about. You've really stayed the same. You're still the same Orhan Pamuk who went to see the Well Digger in 1988. But the country has moved east.
Yes, but that's
and
not
you've stayed the same.
I stayed the same, but 40% of Turkey's population is saying no to Erdogan's party or the constitution they suggested, and 51% is on the other side. So it's an interesting situation that it's easy to leave the country and go other sides. And I advise people, if they feel threatened, they should better leave. But I want to stay in a country where there is still balance and there is possibility of getting rid of the government through election, and government has only 51%, and the opposition has 49%. It's a very head-to-head fight.
And but you're not alone in having this populist uprising. I mean, essentially there are many people in Turkey support Erdogan.
Yes,
and you see this also in other countries in Europe as well. We even have it in the United States as well. There is a sort of change going on in which quite a lot of the old order is being threatened by the way in which the world is evolving.
They are all different. I think that I don't want to dramatize what is called as the illiberal wind. In fact, in the United States, Hillary Clinton got 3 million more votes than Trump. In France, that liberals definitely won. And here I also feel a strong regret about Brexit. And all of this makes us think that maybe the illiberal wind is a bit exaggerated. And also, if we want to fight against these development of nationalism and authoritarianism, we have to.
But when you say it is exaggerated, you mean the media is exaggerating it, or
I'm not saying the media is simplifying just to give the message that yes, there is an increasing nationalism and going inward and anti-immigrant policies developing in all these countries. But they're really different. In United States, the liberal resistance is strong and is effective. Trump cannot impose even his promises, while Turkey is entirely different. Erdogan still gets his 51%, and in the next elections, that's the challenge. The challenge is the next elections in Turkey. It's and one of the reasons why I stay too.
But you talked about people feeling threatened, and if they do, they should leave.
Yes.
But do you feel threatened?
When 50,000 people are in jail, when 180 journalists are jailed, some of them my friends and novelists, not because of their novels, but because of their political journalistic activity, they're in jail for, in the end, for criticizing the government too much. And this is the situation. You don't want to talk too much about, am I afraid, this or that? Yeah, fear is coming to everybody then. And there are so many brave people in Turkey. We all have brave moments. But
You mentioned Brexit. Do you think, I mean, does Turkey still want, do you think, to become a member of the European Union?
I was involved in that process, making even propaganda for Turkey's entry for European Union. But the idea passed away in the last 5 years completely, unfortunately. Turkey is in now, is in the status of a candidate, but that's not a realist situation, but better than nothing. Neither Turkey now, unfortunately, nor Europe is interested in taking Turkey to European Union. I was enthusiastic about many years ago, but I'm not crying now. I'm now more busy about defending free speech in Turkey. That is what should be done, defending basic, essential democratic rights and free speech. That is what should be done.
What's interesting is that you agree with Erdogan that the coup against him was indeed inspired by the religious Mr. Gulen in the United States.
That is also the problem in Turkey. Partly, I believe in it, but partly there is no free speech and we don't know. The media is controlled and there is no transparency about that. Now that we have 14 newspapers, national paper and newspapers of this, only two are in opposition. And then some of them, most important journalists in those opposition newspapers, Cumhuriyet and Sözcü, are also in prison.
How does this become resolved?
I don't know. And I can never predict the future, but I continue to live in Turkey and let's see what will happen.
What is fascinating is that you like to write on this island, one hour off the coast, and you have a place of safety, it seems, both intellectually and physically.
And then
you come back to a flat where you grew up, effectively. So it's very interesting.
I have bodyguards. I am, irony of ironies, protected by the government. I feel at home in Turkey, and I want to continue to stay.
So you have hope?
Yes, but of course, I also teach one semester at United States, at Columbia University. Now I am on the way to New York.
Well, Orhan Pamuk, thank you very much indeed for talking to us, and may you stay safe.
Thank you so much.